Hey guys, welcome to Flight Test. I'm Peter, and today I'm going to show you how to build the FTC Otter. Now basically, the Otter is a four-channel airplane. It's designed for the intermediate to beginner builder and pilot, but if you guys are going to be your first time flying, I highly recommend getting someone with a buddy box or some experience to coach you along. But as far as the build and flying goes, it's actually really easy to build and fly this airplane. So basically, it is a four-channel water plane. It's got a top-mounted motor. It's mounted centerline with the elevator, so basically, when you hammer on the throttle, you don't pitch down or pitch up too much. So let's go and get started with the build. So the very first thing we're going to build is this fuselage. Okay, for the first step in the fuselage, we need to go and remove all of our pieces. Go and remove the paper here, do the pieces here, and go and remove all the little score cuts from the other pieces. So let's get started. The thing we need to use for this is either a knife. But be careful when you do this, because you don't want to press the knife through the surface. The goal is not to cut the paper, but it's to simply score the surface and help score it. Sometimes you don't even need to use the knife. Sometimes you can just pull it off on its own. I find the knife just makes it real easy to kind of get this stuff out of there. So basically you're going to do this for all these parts. Another thing I found too is to get like a credit card or anything sharp, like this little paper airplane, and you can drag it through as well, and also use it to remove all your pieces. That is a lot faster too if you guys aren't as precise with the knife. Okay, so once you've scored and folded all your pieces, basically this is what you're gonna have. You're gonna have your nose pieces, parts of your fuselage as far as the top deck and stuff, your bottom fold over, and the fuselage itself. So we're gonna set these aside, and we're gonna start the fuselage first. First thing I like to do is pull out the paper. Just gonna pull that out. This makes curling the nose in easier, because if you leave the paper on one side, when you try to curl it, it gets wrinkly. So I like to just go and curl just a little bit. Now it's important that you do this just a little bit, because you can actually fold in more, but you can't unfold it when you do this next step. Next step is to take these, figure out which is top and bottom, like that, and then peel off the paper on the top side, or I guess the side that faces inwards towards the fuselage. So basically you see how I'll pull it off, but also keep in mind that these are actually sided for one side, like this is the upside down, and this is the right side up. So once we've figured out which is the right side up, which is upside down, go ahead and pull it out. You're gonna pull the paper off, because if you notice, you try to curl this, see how it wrinkles? That's why we take the paper off, so we can curl inwards easier. Now it's important to just make sure, to reiterate again, to do not fold this up too much. You just want a very light curl in like this. The rest of the curl fold in can be done while we're forming the nose. So you're gonna take a light amount of hot glue, put it on the inside, and then stick it down. Now if you notice, there's actually little score marks too on here that you can kind of see. If you guys are working from plans, you can kind of see it's the blue line or whichever line Dan Sponholz does. He actually does our PDFs now, which makes the designs a lot easier to read and build. So once these are done, it's time to move on to our tail section. We're actually gonna start by gluing this piece in first. But first we're actually gonna go and roll this up, make sure this guy folds up just nice. And we'll fold this guy up too. You can kind of see how I slowly work into it to try to get that 90 degree angle established. Once we're happy, just put some glue in there. Now this is a B fold, and B means besides, because if you notice, this side part goes beside this part right here. You can kind of see a diagram like right here of what a B fold is. Go and grab something about 90 degrees, slide it in there just to make sure that this stays nice and vertical with the surface. Once that's done, you'll notice that we actually have two little etch lines right here. This just helps kind of curl the tail in, because if you notice, the plane's a little bit more tapered in the end to get it a little more aerodynamic and make it look better. So we're gonna fold this up just a little bit. And now it's time to go and move on to our center section right here. Go ahead and put some glue right here. Fold this up. Take your 90 degree thing. Make sure it stays nice and 90. And wait till it cools down. Once it's cooled down, repeat the same process for the other side. So once that's nice and dry, the last thing to do is go and glue in this side right here. I find the easiest way to do this is kind of hold it like this and just pump some glue in there like that. Now, when pressing this piece down, it's important to notice the tail here. If you notice, I can actually go beyond that. I can go a little bit before that. The thing you need to do here is make sure that stays nice and parallel with the other surface right here. So the way I like to do this is take it, move it to our table edge, press down on it, make sure it's nice and lined up, check it for consistency, and let it cool down. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to get this hull part right here. This is the front part of the step. So we're going to take this right here, and if you notice, we're going to make it an A-fold right here. So basically, I'm going to put some glue in here, fold this up. Now, if you notice, I'm actually going to beyond the fold. This is basically because the hull is actually tapered like this. Now, if you notice, you want to try to match the angle as close as possible, but it's not a big deal even if you're about 5 to 10 degrees off. You can kind of just bend it with your hands and form it the shape you need. But that's about where it needs to be right there. For the next step, we need to make sure this paper is peeled off. And we're just gonna go and trial fit this on. So I'm just gonna go and check it in here and line it up. Just to make sure everything seems nice and snug. Once I'm pretty happy with that, I'm gonna take this out. Now if you notice, this is a score fold right here. We're just gonna go and fold that down, pop it out. This just makes gluing this a little bit easier, so we only have to glue one step at a time. So we don't have to glue the whole thing at once, because that could be pretty difficult to manage. Now since this part's gonna be mostly underwater, it's important to use enough glue here to make sure this is nice and sealed. So I'm going to put just a good amount in the cracks, especially in this corner right here. Get the top part there. And then go ahead and insert it into the fuselage. Now it's important right here because this is actually a lot of hot glue and it's pretty hot and it's kind of oozing out. It's important to work very carefully with your hands, kind of like lightly depressing the surfaces and moving them together. It's not a big deal if you actually have a crack here for the water. You just have to make sure that the glue has sealed the actual foam to the paper itself on the inside to keep the water out. If you guys want later, you can actually go over this in hot glue and just smear it down for more thorough sealing. Now, another thing to do is actually if you have a lot of hot glue kind of oozing out, you can kind of take some paper and just scrape it off. So the next step is to go and fold this back and go and just pre-bend this a little bit. This helps with the nose forming, so it makes it a lot easier to kind of form this ahead of time rather than trying to form around the nose. Otherwise, it might bunch up a little bit, and it can be a little difficult to glue down. I'm going to fold it and roll it nice and tight. Now, the first thing I like to do is just go and just fold this over and just check it just for consistency once, just so I kind of can go ahead and plan ahead before I actually put the glue down. Should look like that when you actually do glue it. So to go and do this, I'm going to unfold this. If you notice, there's a little score up here too. You can just go and crack that down. We're going to start with the bottom first because we don't want to glue the whole thing at once because that could be pretty difficult to do. Go ahead and press it down. And once again, if you have a little bit of glue oozing out the sides, you can just kind of smear it off. All right, for the next step, we need to glue the top of the nose in. So go ahead and put some glue around here. You don't need to use as much glue for this part because this part's not going underwater, but you just want to make sure your glue joint's strong and good enough. So get enough on there and go and fold it over. So that's how you complete the nose. Now you guys want to be careful when you build your own nose because this actually can be pretty difficult, especially with the reinforcement pieces in there to get your nose to be nice and straight and pretty looking. But if you build these things after a couple times, you eventually do get it down to science. So that's how you do that. Now for the next step, we need to take our straight edge or ruler or whatever you got laying around, place it on the top, line up both sides, and go ahead and cut it off. Now if you notice, I'm cutting at an angle. This is to match the kind of nose canopy thing I got going on in there. It should come off like that. Next step is to take this piece right here, and we're actually gonna glue it in right here. But if you notice, it actually doesn't fit. We need to actually bevel this. So how I'm gonna bevel that is I'm gonna hold up to my table edge right here and be very careful because this is a pretty big knife blade. Kind of go ahead and bevel this off. If you guys are uncomfortable using the knife, you can use some sandpaper to do this too. It works just as well. If you guys are having a little bit of trouble fitting this, you can always take your knife and just shave off just a little bit more in here. Okay, so that's pretty much how you finish up the nose part of it. That finishes the top part of the inside where your instrument panel would be if this was a real airplane. You guys can decorate that however you want, or you can use the canopy to cover all this up, which I'll show you a little bit later on in the build. Okay, so this is the one of the top pieces. This is basically where you're gonna feed your motor wires through, and this part goes on the back catch right here. So, insulation is simply just putting some glue right here, and on this side, and sticking in. Okay, so now it's time to finish up the rest of our bottom portions of the fuselage. I'm gonna start with this piece right here. This basically is built the exact same way as this piece is done. So another A-fold is necessary. Just gonna curl that up like there just to make sure it fits. Put some glue in that channel and fold this up. Once it's nice and cooled down, you can actually go ahead and put some glue in this channel here and run all the way to the front. Now once again, it's important to make sure you got enough glue in this because this part is actually going to be underwater and seaplanes don't work that well if they're full of water. Once again, once it's slipped in, you may notice the little glue oozes out. You can just take some paper and kind of press that down. Now for the last step, you have this last scrap right here. This part just gets glued in the same way. Go ahead and make sure there's plenty of glue on this piece as well. And slip it on in. And smear this down. Now the last thing to do is to go and finish sealing up our fuselage. So if you notice, you actually have the little gaps here. So just take your glue gun and just go and pump them full of glue. You actually don't need to use too much glue, just put enough just to completely cover that seam. A hot glue is actually a very good gap filling glue. So it works excellent for this waterproof stuff. Now for the next thing, we actually have this little piece right here that covers up this guy right here. You don't actually have to install this right now. We're actually going to set this aside and wait for later. And sometimes I actually just omit this piece too. This is just used if you want to clean up your airplane and make it a little bit neater. For this step, we're going to go and complete our tail section and servo assembly. Alright, so for the tail section, we're going to need a couple things. We're going to need this double fold-over former thing, your rudder and vertical stabilizer assembly, the horizontal stabilizer assembly, and your elevator pieces. So the first thing I like to do is go ahead and bevel this. So if you notice, I'm actually not cutting through the surface once again. I'm just lightly scoring this so I can fold it out like that. Go ahead and take this and do the 45 degree bevel. Now, if you guys aren't comfortable doing the beveling, you can actually use a sanding block or some sandpaper to do this. You don't have to use the knife. The knife is a little bit more difficult to do and it's a little bit more dangerous too. So if you guys are kind of new to this, definitely check out the sandpaper. Done, so like that. Now the thing about this new waterproof foam board is actually find the hot glue hinging to be not super necessary. The paper is actually bonded on here really, really strong and I haven't had any of it really come off yet. But if you guys do feel like beefing it up, I do recommend doing the hot glue hinges. And I will only be doing the hot glue hinges just for this part of the airplane, mainly because the rudder is so large and it's also in contact with the water. So to do a hot glue hinge, you put some hot glue in here, just about to about here. You can stop there. Grab some scrap foam and smear it down until you get to the top. This kind of just helps seal in the paper to the foam edge. Just kind of leave it at this angle and just set it aside and let it cool down. The next thing we do is we take this guy right here, and we're actually going to pop this center section out. Let me get my thing. And we're going to pull the paper off in here. And we're going to take something kind of like rough, like this kind of edge, and kind of curl this down. This kind of helps this part fold right over. You can kind of see how I'm kind of like digging a channel in here and kind of like enlarging it. That just makes this part really easy to do. Once this part is set, just go ahead and flex the rudder a little bit. Make sure it moves nice and easy. And just go ahead and plan ahead and just kind of check this just a few times before actually gluing it. We're actually going to line all these up right here, like so. Once you guys are happy with that, take this part off. Actually, before we do that, we have one more thing to do. You can go ahead and glue this in if you want, but we need to bevel this for a nicer finish. So once again, I'm going to take my knife and bevel this out. Now, if you notice, I'm on the inside surface of this. This is the inside, and this is the outside. So I'm going to take this and bevel with a knife. You guys can feel free to use a sanding block or some other forms of methods of doing this. I just find the knife the easiest way that I do it. Going to clean this up, make sure it's nice and about evenly beveled. And then you should have something that looks like this. You can kind of notice how it's kind of turned into like a blade on the edge. With this blade, we're actually going to try to make it match this top surface right here. So to do this, I'm going to come to the table edge like this and kind of just press and roll it up. You can go a little bit beyond that too because we're going to glue down our next step. But go ahead and roll it up on both sides. When you fold it over, it just looks something like that. Okay, once we've done that, it's time to take this, put some glue on this surface right here, put enough glue here on the bottom, fill this area in here, and go on the trailing edge of this right here. Take this part and lay it down in as close as you can. Go ahead and take your time and make sure this is lined up nice and even. It's also a good idea to compare it on the top too. You can kind of see this little angle right here. Now for the next step, we actually need to remove this little insert piece. So if you notice, it's kind of already kind of scored or cut all the way through, but it's stopped right here. We just need to finish the cut with our knife. Pull that out. Now we're going to just pre-fold this over just to kind of get an idea of how this is going to fit. You kind of notice right now it doesn't fit all the way to the edge. So to help move that along, I might need to take my knife here, the back of it, and just kind of roll this edge over just a little bit. Pull that down and over. Once I'm happy with that, I'm going to take my glue. Glue it on the nose again. Make sure you get this bottom part nice and glued up. Glue all of that and come up to here. I want to stop right there and fold this over. It also helps too because since this is paper and paper kind of, you can kind of feel the heat of hot glue come through paper. Take some scrap foam and just kind of rub this down. That'll help seal that in. Then just look like that. Last thing you do is plug this little piece out right here. And now it's time to slide our elevator half in. But before we slide the elevator half in, we need to bevel this real quick. So once again, I'm just gonna lightly depress on the surface, not cutting all the way to the paper on the other side, because the paper on the other side acts as the hinge. Do our 45 degree bevels. You just fold it down, check for fit, and finish. If you notice on the Speedball kit, it actually kind of nicks here, mainly because this cutout hasn't finished cutting all the way through. If you guys are wondering what that double line is on our plans, that's just to remove that. That helps this part move freely. Go ahead and take this and slide it in. Now, if you notice, there actually is a top and bottom. The bottom is where the bottom of the hinges are, or the bevels. And we're going to slide in like this. Now, you're going to slide in just to get the hinge line right here in line with this surface up here. So if you notice, I'm going to move those so you can kind of see them. Once you guys are happy with that, it's time to add some hot glue. Now, you notice it actually is flared up a little right here. You can kind of work it up there just a little bit to get maximum glue in there. Pump enough glue in there. Get some glue around this side. And this side. Go and roll it up again here. Once you're done with that, go ahead and press down it. Make sure it's nice and flush with this top surface, or bottom surface in this case. While you're waiting for that to cool down dry, it's a good idea to take something that's 90 degrees and check this for consistency. For this next step, we're going to go and install our elevator servo. Now, the way I like to do this is I like to take this servo connector and kind of curl this down just a little bit, just so it's easy to kind of tuck in through the top surface. So to get in here, I move it in like here, and just kind of just feed this wire through it, just till it pops out. This can be a little bit slow and tedious process, but just wiggle it around, you eventually get it all the way through the top, or the bottom in this case. Now, another thing too, you might notice the connector might get a little hung up. You can take one of your extra push rods right here and just kind of grab it and just kind of wiggle it around so you can snag it and pull it out. Now, the way this works is basically just nesting the surface like that. This is just a nice, easy way to clean up the servo installation so you don't have wires kind of like draped all over the tail. Once we're happy with that, we're just gonna put some glue in the servo, some there. Some there, and some on this side. And just slip it in. While that's cooling, we can add our elevator connection bar. So if you notice, your elevators are actually split into two pieces. This is just for assembly. You're gonna take a popsicle stick, like this guy over here. You can use the full length if you want, but it's not really necessary, so I'm gonna cut it down a little bit. You're going to glue it in at the top just like that. Now when gluing this in, I actually glued it a little bit away from the hinge line. Just about 2 millimeters or so. Now it's important to kind of clamp this down pretty good and let it completely cool down and dry. Because you want to make sure both elevator halves are level with each other. So they move up and down, they move up and down equally. Now, the last thing you can do is install our control horn. I'm going to just kind of like press check it in there just to see where it is. It should go in like that. Actually, while doing this, I've actually got linkage stoppers on our servos too. So I'm going to undo the linkage stopper just a little bit. Take our push rod. Slide this into the outermost hole for me, but for you guys, you might want to do the intermediate hole, which is the middle. Well, actually, I'll just go in the middle hole too. I'll just go through there, like that. Flip this over. A little hot glue in there. Slip that through. And nest that into that surface just like that. Now for this part, you can just cut it off with the, either a Dremel tool or some pliers. The way I like to cut this off is I like to have this surface perfectly level, just like that. Make sure our servo is centered. I already checked and centered the servo. If you guys need instructions on how to do that, you can check out the FT Tiny Trainer build video, which shows you how to really set up your plane from start to finish. So once I make sure that surface is level and the servo is centered, I'm going to cut this extra piano wire off. Now if you notice, I'm not going to cut it right at the surface. I'm going to cut it about let's say half an inch above more, because this gives me room to make adjustments too if I need them. You really shouldn't need them, but this is just in case. Cut that off. I'm just going to leave this loose for now. I'm actually going to tighten that screw. We'll do that a little bit later when this is all completely set up. So for this step, we're going to take our tail and install it to the fuselage. So bring your fuselage over. And if you notice, you got this kind of like U-channel thing right here. We're going to go and finish this cut. So go ahead and cut that out there. Cut it all the way to the back side. Pop that out. Now it's important too here, you notice that we have this servo wire that only goes this far. We need to do something about that. So get your extensions, plug one into here. And we're actually just put a little bit of glue in here to kind of lock this into place. Now if you guys are going to be flying this off of salt water, be sure to check out our waterproofing electronics video to check out how to use corrosion X or some other corrosion inhibitor to how to really seal these connectors up. Because if there's corrosion in here, it'll cause a problem later on as far as flying and controlling your servos. But for fresh water, it's really not necessary. So we're going to slip this in here. It might help to kind of crush this and taper it a little bit, so you can just crush it with your hands like that. Just kind of roll that up together. Slide it on in. Now if you notice, on this side there's two little dots right here. This is in the speed build kit. If you guys have been listening from plans, you'll see the little dots there. You guys just kind of, you can take a marker or draw a line through here if you really need help lining it up. I can kind of see where the level point is, so I'm just going to go ahead and use them like that. I'm going to sink them down just to the surface. We kind of see that the dots kind of line up right there. So once you guys are sliding this in, you want to make sure that this is nice and straight up and down. So you can kind of see how it moves around right here. I'm going to put some glue in here, and I'm going to hold it as straight as possible and keep it nice and 90 degrees. This part's not super essential to get 90 degrees. It just really shows off your workmanship if you're a really good builder. One thing I like to do is go and back this piece out just a little bit. Since this is the tail of the build, water can still enter here because this does touch the water just a little bit. So I'm going to get enough glue on this surface, enough glue on this surface, glue all over here, get it in there as well, roll this over, put more glue here, and glue there. I'm going to start walking it into the airplane. Now with that nice and set, and that's perfectly level, I'm going to go ahead and just check back here, looking at it from the back, and it looks nice and straight. So I'm going to hold it right there until it's completely cooled down and dried, and then we'll move on to the next step. For the last step, we need to install our rudder servo to the airplane. You'll notice that little knockout there, I just kind of cut that out and pushed it through. Now if you notice, we don't have enough wire here. I mean, this is almost enough if you even install your receiver in here, but it's a little tedious work. So I'm going to get another extension right here. This is a little bit too longer, but this is what's included in the kit, but you can get a smaller one if you have them spare. Put some glue on this just to lock it down. Slip it on in. I'm going to slide this into the airplane. Now once you've installed the servo, the last thing to do is to put a control horn and linkage in. So for this one, I actually like to use the outside hole because you're going to need the most throw on the rudder, because in the water, the plane will try to fishtail a lot into the wind, so I prefer maximum throws to have better water stability. I'm going to slip that in there just to check it. Alright, once I'm happy with that, I'm going to pull it out, open up the linkage to make sure I can slide this wire in. Put some glue in this control horn crack. Slide on back. Now once this is perfectly centered and the servo horn is centered, I'm gonna go and cut it off again, just about half an inch beyond the top of the linkage stopper, just to give me some room for adjustments. And that's how you complete the tail section for the airplane. Now it's time to go and build our wing assembly and install it into our fuselage. So these are the parts you need to gather in order for the wings. Now, if you guys have built your planes in the past, you probably realize these actually look really familiar. These actually are the PVD-1 wings, pretty much almost unmodified. The only thing really that happens is these control horns have moved out a little bit, and I add these little pockets in to make it easier to install servos. So first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and just bevel them. Just gonna fold this side over like that. Bevel it with your knife. You guys may find it might be easier to do this with some sandpaper, once again, if you guys are not familiar with the knife, because the knife is a little bit more trickier to use. And if you do use the knife, make sure you got a really sharp one. Go do the same thing for the other side. Once your double bevels are done, they should look like this. And if you notice, I kind of stop right here where this surface stops, because this is going to fold over like that. And there's no need to really bevel the rest of the surface. Next thing I like to do is go and score this inner surface to make the fold over easier. The best way to do this is to take like a barbecue skewer, just press down to the crack, and just drag it along. Go ahead and do this for both wings. And last but not least for this, we actually need to move this little inside right here. So I'm actually just gonna score this just a little bit. Pull this out. And we're gonna finish it off with this thing. Now we kind of just roll this over just to see how it kind of happens. You kind of see where we kind of pre-scored it, that it already kind of makes a nice airfoil shape. So I'm just going to roll over just like that. Do the same thing for the other side. You don't need to press down a lot, just kind of like pre-tension it, I guess, would be the right word for this. Once we're done with that, we're going to take our spars, and we're going to carefully open up the score line again. For this, I actually like to use the knife because I want to make sure this is straight, parallel, up and down, and it's a nice, smooth, even cut. So I'm going to roll through all the way. And basically, what we're doing is we're going to get these. Put some glue in there. For this step, we need to pop out these little knockouts. These are kind of like alignment pads for the spars. Now we're gonna take our spars and we're gonna glue them in right here, right here. Do the same thing for the other side. All right, next thing you need to do is take these strips right here, and we're gonna glue them in like this. We're just gonna line up that little surface right there where you can see the edge line. And we're gonna put them in. Go ahead and let all the stuff cool down and dry, and then we'll move on to the next step. All right, once all those parts have cooled down, it's time to go ahead and I'll do the fold over for a wing. I like to put glue on this bar first right here. And then fold this over. Now it's important when you do this, because this is actually one of the older style wings, but I find it works just fine, is this actually is more susceptible to build error. Now if you notice this kind of rocks up and down, what you want to kind of do is kind of hold this down, but also hold that nice and parallel with the bottom surface to establish the right amount of camber in the swing. Once that's done, go ahead and open up the wing like this. Put some glue here. And then fold it down and hold it. It helps if you actually go to the table edge right here, because this wing is actually tapered, so this part actually overhangs just a little bit more. So just gonna hold that down, let it cool. And that's how you complete one side of the wing. We're basically gonna do the same thing for the other side too. Just before you fold it, you're gonna need to look over your wing just like this. You notice this spar right here, or runs up along this ridge like that. The middle spar here, your double bevel, and your pre-crease fold things. So once again, just gonna do this just like the other wing. All right, so basically, these are your completed wing halves. It's now time to do the final wing assembly. So if you notice, one of these has a little bit of like this weird paper gap thing. We're gonna fill this all up with hot glue and bond it to the other surface. So I'm gonna grab my hot glue, get plenty of it up on there. Get plenty on that spar. Take this half and carefully shove it in there. Kind of helps if you got like a hang up right here. Kind of just flick the paper out. Press it in there. And also for this step, you're gonna need to get your fuselage. Use this part, this half of right here is the tail for the proper dihedral gauge. You can vary just a couple degrees up or down. It's not really a big deal. But yeah, that establishes about the right amount of dihedral for this wing. For the next step, we need to install our wing into the fuselage. To do this, you'll notice that this is actually not perfectly cut all the way. That's made this way for fuselage assembly, so it's you don't crinkle it as much. So just go ahead and remove these parts. Once you're done with that, it's time to slide our wing in. Now, if you notice, you have paper on one side and kind of like paper on not one side, it's best to slide it in going this way. Now you're not trying to slide against the grain, try to rub the paper out. So we're gonna go in this way into the fuselage. So to do this, you need to be very careful and just slowly just kind of wiggle it all the way in until you get all the way to the center. It also helps too if you be careful of your pressure points here and there so you don't crinkle and fold these. It's really not the end of the world if you crinkle it. It's just more of an aesthetic thing if you do buckle the sides in. So once you guys have kind of slid in there, you kind of notice that you may be one side more than the other. For this part, it's actually pretty easy just to kind of eyeball it and just get it lined up just right. So I'm gonna shift this back and forward just till I get the center V section lined up right level. And if you guys look, you can actually kind of compare the wingtips to the tail and see just how level you are. So just a little bit of shifting here and there, we'll get it. That looks pretty level. Now it's time to take some hot glue and bond this in. Next thing you do is take these little scrap pieces right here, and you're gonna fit them in right here. Best way I like to do this is just kind of actually just rock them in. This actually helps keep some of the water out, because right here's a step, and if you guys know, when you're moving an airplane or anything through water, it tends to splash and get water everywhere. So I put these little pockets right here to keep most of the water out, because the water will be splashing up here and getting all over the surface. So I'll just put some glue there, just kind of cap it, and some glue in the bottom. And just take some scrap foam and just smear the rest of the glue down. Do the same thing for their side. For this step, we're going to move on to our pontoon assembly for the wings. So basically you got these things right here that look like this. The best way to frame reference these things up is kind of like line it up with the nose right here. Don't worry too much about this part touching the surface. Each wing builds a little bit differently, so you may have more or less camber. I'm not going to worry too much about folding up to the surface. You can fold them nice and flush if you want, but it's not entirely necessary. So to do this step, we're going to take this, put some hot glue here and there, and put some on this little gap right here. And also get this little funny gauge thing we have. If you notice, this is the only out of place part in this kit. We're gonna use it to set this angle. So I'm gonna go and slap this down. Notice I'm gonna take this gauge right here and place it right about here. And that sets just about the right amount of angle for this thing to be parallel with the bottom of the airplane. Once you guys are done with that, it's time to take a skewer, and just very, about right here, where the little knockout part is, punch your skewer through, and drive it into the wing. At this stage, it's also nice to have this little angle gauge once again. And if you guys get a little confused about the angle gauge, it's the more less than 90 degree angle, it's the kind of shortest one right here. Use it to line it up right there. Once I'm satisfied with that, go ahead and glue the skewer down. I just put a little glue there and swirl the skewer a little bit to kind of get all the glue in the cracks and make sure it stays nice and still. Go ahead and snip off the excess. And do the same thing for the other side. Once you guys are done with that, it's time to install our little tip floats. You notice there's a little bit of a score line here. We're just gonna pull that paper out. And we're actually going to fold this in like that. This kind of just helps the water kind of like skip off of this. If you've basically seen like a rock skip along the water, you know, rocks are heavy and they sink. But if you keep the forward momentum moving, they tend to stay on top of the surface. That's basically how these work, even though they do float. Put some glue in there. Squish it down and smear the excess off. Just going to hold in that angle and let it dry. And do the same thing for the other side. Once those have cooled off, you'll notice there's a little bit of a score here in the shape of the little bottom parts of our little step things. We're actually going to pull this paper out to get a really, really nice burn-in bond here for the hot glue. So with that, I'm going to score that, peel that out. I'm going to put a good amount of hot glue in this. Then I'm going to attach it to this part right here. I'm going to kind of press it down kind of hard and kind of burn it in there and let it sink right in. And also, I'm going to take my fuselage, rotate it this way. And if the fuselage is nice and flat on the table, I'm going to kind of reference this part right here and make sure it's nice and parallel with this part of the hull. For the last step, we need to install our servos. Before we do that, we're going to open up these little cavities right here. So I'm going to use my knife blade, kind of slide in there, kind of just go ahead and pop that out, just like that. Do the same thing for the other side. Now we're going to slip our wire harness in, or you can do your servos first, either one, but we're going to do the wire harness. So do this, we're going to roll this up to the top, go ahead and slide one end in. You kind of notice how you have two females right here, and a male. The male goes into your receiver, but the two females will go out to the wings. just gonna slide them right there right now. I still have the male and female on the front, but we're gonna just do one side at a time. Roll this over. You can see it comes out just right there. Just gonna tug on it, leave it there. Grab one of our servos. And go and straighten out the wire as best as possible. This makes snaking this thing in a lot easier. So I just pull it nice and taut, stretch that out. Yeah. There it is. Sometimes it helps if you shake it vigorously. Or tap on it. Eventually that wire will come out. Until you snag it, just like that. Go ahead and plug it in. Close the fold down. But before you close it, make sure this is nice and straight, or your connector's in the right way too. And once again, for those of you who don't know, the yellow or white wire, depending on what kind of servos you have and extensions you have, is a signal wire. The red one's your positive, and the brown or black one is your negative. Close that up and tape it shut. Now, once you're done with that, it's time to repeat the process on the other side. Once you guys are done fishing them in, it's also time to glue and secure our servos in. These are actually pretty snug and tightened already, but just to make sure, I'm gonna put a little bead of hot glue around it just to lock it in. Same thing for their side. And the last thing to do is do our linkages and servo horns and stuff for them. So this is done the same way as our surface. I'm just gonna slide the rod through the linkage stopper. Actually, one thing we didn't do yet, we actually need to bevel this first. So I'm gonna leave that alone. I'm gonna go and open up this surface right here. Pop this down and do our 45 degree bevel. Once that's done, we can come back to the servo. Move this down, insert it into the control surface, make sure wheel is nice and free, and go ahead and hot glue that down. Once the servo is pretty centered and lined up, and the control surface is lined up, I'm going to cut off just a half an inch of the wire again. Just snug that down for now. We'll tighten these later before we fly. And do the same thing to the other side. So once again, we're gonna slide our linkage in. And if you notice for the ailerons, I'm gonna just use the middle hole because I don't need a whole lot to throw on this, but I do like quite a bit. And the middle hole seems to work just fine. I'm gonna slide it in. Put a little glue there. And punch this into the surface. For this step, we're going to build our motor mount pod and install our motor and ESC. We're going to need to get this part right here. This is basically our motor mount pod, our standoff mount, and our firewall. This basically uses just the normal power pack firewalls, even though this is not a swappable. So the first thing we need to do is go and score and open this up and get out these pieces. Once you guys have dug out the channel, it's time to remove some paper here. And if you guys notice, this is actually a B-fold, so it's beside. So these little pod things right here will go up just beside, just like that. I'll put some glue there. Fold it up. I'm gonna grab some about 90 degrees again, just to make sure this stays nice and straight. And do the same thing for their side. Next thing you do is kind of take these nose parts and kind of curl them up just a little bit. This kind of help form this next stage. And you can also unfold this too and kind of roll this up as well. I had to go and just trial fold this just to kind of see what's going to happen next. Eventually you get something looks like that. So, go and fold this. Go and break it here again, because we can just go and fold this as one assembly, rather than trying to do all this in one shot. Pull that down. Be careful of the hot glue too, because it does like to ooze out of this pot assembly. Just going to take some paper and kind of catch the excess and smear it off. Once it's dried and cool, you can go ahead and finish off the last step. I like to use a table for this too. Just gotta make sure this stays nice and flush. Go ahead and pull this thing out too. And now you can go ahead and set this aside. Next thing you do is to take this. This is also gonna be double bevel. So you're gonna bevel one side with a 45 and do the same thing to the other side. Go ahead and fold it over. Now you kind of see it's a little off-center, so I'm just going to just straighten this out with my hands, just kind of force it to do what I want until it gets there. Once we're satisfied with it, we're going to take some glue and just put some glue on the surface. Close it like a book and hold it shut. For this step, we're going to take this thing and glue this into there. So the way I like to do that is to put enough glue on here, just get enough to completely cover the surface. Take this end and slide it into there. Now if you notice, you'll see the score mark inside for this part right here. That'll basically give you your lateral adjustments as far as too far to the left, too far to the right. So just keep it nice and straight and press it down and let it cool. You can also see the reference holes on here once again to make sure you're perfectly nice and level. This part shouldn't be necessary, but just in case you can kind of see the levelness of it. The next step is to take this thing over here and slide it in here. All right, the last thing to do is to put some glue here. Get plenty of glue on this too, because this is gonna hold your motor too as well. So your motor will be vibrating and moving a lot. So it's best to make sure this is stuck firmly to the airplane. Slide that down. So it also helps if you get this scrap out of the way too. Once again, you can see these reference holes right here to make sure you stab it to the right angle. If you notice, I'm a little nose down right now, so I'm just gonna rock this back a little bit until these look pretty much parallel and level. When you're satisfied with that, look at it from the front and make sure you're not leaning the pod left to the right too much. Once that's cooled down and cured, you can take your hot glue and just finish up these gaps and joints right here. So last thing is your firewall. Now if you notice, this thing is actually a little offset, a little bit to the left. So I like to keep these two barbecue skewer holes on the right side of the airplane. So basically what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take the hot glue and get plenty of hot glue on the surface, because remember, your motor's attached to this. You don't want it to fall off, or unless you want to turn your plane into a glider. Go ahead and slap that on. Go ahead and press it into the surface and let it stick itself in nice and tight. Now, it's a good idea if you're going to put a really, really big motor on this. This plane is designed for the B and C pack on our store, and they will stay on just fine with this current assembly. But if you guys are going to put even, something even bigger or faster, it's a good idea to take some tape, some fiberglass tape, because it's got the strands in it, and go around here to there to kind of like really stick the mount on so it doesn't fall off. For this plane, I'm going to use the B-pack motor. Basically, how you mount this one is you undo these little 1.5 millimeter Allen screws on the motor mount standoff. That'll fall off. You can take this thing, line it up there, and screw it on. So we need some servo screws to mount this thing in. In our servo packs, they have four additional screws. You can use these to stick them in there. They actually do fit in these holes without falling through, so you can use them. Now you take your motor, slip it in, and tighten these set screws. All right, last thing you do is plug the ESC in. The way this works is you basically just plug your ESC in any order into these three wires here. If your propeller turns the wrong way, you simply just switch two out of the three wires and the propeller will turn the other way. Now this plane is also designed for an 8-inch propeller at the max. You can kind of see that's kind of where it comes, so unless you want to cut your fuselage up and make big holes in it, I wouldn't go beyond 8-inch propeller. For this step, I'm going to show you how to install our optional clear canopy, the closed canopy, how to reinforce the hull and various materials you can use to do this, and the battery tray. So the first thing I'm going to show you is how to build this optional canopy. There isn't really any way to mount this thing yet. It was more of just a last minute decision, mainly because I saw in the comment section that you guys actually wanted a closed canopy for some of you guys. So I've made this option that fits on the airplane. I haven't really figured out a way to mount it because I don't really use these. I really like this plane as an open cockpit. But if you guys can just simply just take this on or add some barbecue skewer pegs or anything just like that. So to assemble this, we do the same thing we do with the other parts. Just going to remove out these little knockouts, peel off the paper here, kind of pre-roll this. And this is a B-fold, such as the thing I just removed. These sides will roll up like here, and this will roll up like that. So we can go and glue it. The last thing is going to cut this little excess tail piece off right here. So I just take my straight edge, line it to the top, and simply just cut it off. Now canopy does go right here, just goes like that. There are no ways to really mount it yet, but for those of you who are going to use this, I would probably recommend some way of actually removing it in and out, mainly because if you try to hinge it here, it bumps into your pod, or if you do it here, it bumps into there. That's why I really don't use this canopy. It's just an option for those of you who want to create something that revolves around it. But I'm going to show you to use this, which is basically our open cockpit windshield. This is basically the same thing. Just kind of remove these little inset portions here. It's going to be a B-fold. And this will go like right here. Now, I do want to make this out of some clear material. So what I did find is that basically you can use almost any of these clear plastics. This is just some servo packaging. But really, you can get these from like well, this is a Grabner package, but you can get really any plastic from any of those clamshell packaging things you get from Walmart. Almost tons of commercial grade stuff comes in this weird plastic, but I'm gonna use this. So basically what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put this here. I'm gonna grab a Sharpie and trace it out. Now you guys can cut this plastic out with a knife or some scissors. I just got this knife handy, so I'm gonna use the knife. I'm gonna line up there to make sure it fits. I'm gonna make little reference points right here where the folds need to be. Grab my straight edge. Line up at the bottom of the canopy because I know that's going to be 90 degrees. Draw a line. Draw one more line over here. I'm going to make sure the Sharpie dries, so I'm just going to wave this around just a little bit to let that ink fully cure. But if you guys do make a mistake and smudge it, isopropyl alcohol or rubbing alcohol is great for removing Sharpies off of any sort of plastic and materials. Once that's done, I'm simply gonna come to the table edge and just kind of lightly fold this a little bit. Once I got a little bit of a fold established, I can just kind of pick it up and just finish folding it. If you guys find your plastics kind of brittle and breaks, try to get different plastics, or if you can, try to heat it to help your bending. But for most of these plastics, they bend just fine with just a little bit of elbow grease. And that sits on just like that. So attach the canopy. I simply put two dots of hot glue right here. Actually, rails of hot glue. And sit it in there. Just like that. And also in the front, I use two dabs of hot glue right about here and there. And smush this down in there and wait for the glue to completely cool down. Also, while you're doing that, if you have a lot of glue on the excess size, you can just kind of smear it off just to the side. So once we're done with the canopy, it's now time to do something about our hull. Now, if you guys are going to paint this, you can kind of disregard most of this, but it might be a good idea to still do some reinforcement if you guys are really going to abuse the seaplane. So as you notice, this is just a normal paper hull. It's the water resistant stuff. This stuff does pick up water if you do leave it in for very long extended amounts of time. But if you do paint it, it tends to reject almost all water. But for this part, since it's gonna be hitting land and stuff, and you know, maybe you're hitting some sticks in the water, I highly recommend you go to Walmart and grab some plastic folders, or even this plastic kind of clamshell packaging too will work just fine if you can get a big enough sheet to put on top of this. But since we don't have those right now, and some of you guys may not have it, I'm just gonna put some tape on here just to make this a little bit more slick and durable. So to do this step, I simply just grab some tape and just lay it on the hull. You can kind of overlap it too. I just go maybe about, let's say that's about a quarter of an inch and a half. Press the tape down. It's also good to try this step is to grab a Sharpie and slowly rub this down to get the most wrinkle-free finish. Now, as far as tackling these curves right here, it's a good idea to get your knife or scissors and cut a bunch of little relief cuts. This makes tackling this step a lot easier as far as pulling over the tape one piece at a time. that's pretty much how you tape up the hull. You can also do the same thing for the floats, but I find them not super necessary because they don't really touch the water too much unless you're at a standstill or turning really, really sharp. But to show you what the folder looks like, I'm going to grab another airplane. Now, this is the one in the product release video. You guys can see it is like a plastic sheet. I actually got this one from the Star Wars X-Wing box. It was a big enough piece of clear plastic. I just got it, stuck it on there with some hot glue, sanded it down, and just painted it. And it looks just fine. Like, you can't really even tell that's there. And I really only find this step necessary just for this main part of the hull. These back parts don't have it. You can do it if you want, but be cautious, because if you do put stuff back there that's behind the center of gravity, it's going to make your plane tail heavy, so you're going to need to add more nose weight to compensate for that. All right, so that's how you complete the hull. Now, the last thing to do for this part of the accessories and finalizing the build is the battery tray. Now, basically, this is a B-fold, you know, so it means beside. I'm going to go and open up and remove these little cappies again. So you notice in this thing, actually these little holes. These are actually for Velcro straps. So I'm going to use my flight test strap right here and thread it through the hole. Yeah, it goes like that. So basically you pull the strap up through like this so you can see the logo on this side. Then this goes in like this. You put your battery in there and you pull this loop over and then it's stuck down. Now it's a good idea to make sure this Velcro strap's on the right side because it's actually really hard to remove and reinsert once this part is glued into the airplane. So it's a good idea if you're gonna use some heavy batteries to also reinforce this. I've had no problems at all with this stuff tearing out with the 2200 3S, but if you guys are doing something crazy or crashing a lot or going to use this airplane, put a paint stick or a popsicle stick in there just to make it a little bit more sturdy. Next step is insertion. I'm gonna get a good idea of what I'm gonna do. It's basically just gonna sit in here like this. You guys can move it depending on where you want it. But I find as far as it can go up in the nose and about the width of a 2200 3 cell to be the perfect amount. So to glue this thing in, I'm going to take this out, move my wires and stuff out of the way, and put some glue on the inside surface, about where it's going to be. It's a good idea to go just a little bit above, because you can just smear this hot glue down with this little tray thing when you get it in there. So I'm just going to press that down, get all the hot glue on there. So that's pretty much how you insert the battery tray. So the first thing we're going to do with the receiver install is get your receiver side. I'm using this 8-channel Grapner receiver. As you notice, one of the antennas is actually missing, but this is okay just for some test flights because we still have one antenna. That's why these things have diversity. So it's a random side note. This is broken. So the first thing we do is identify your channels. If you guys are building a 4-channel airplane, it's okay to consult which radio do you buy because some of the channel mappings are different. Basically, we have 1, 2, 3, and 4 because this is a 4-channel airplane, which is basically four controls. We have your throttle, Ailerons, elevator, and rudder. So on this receiver, the layout for this one, and it's not the same for all of them once again, is one is going to be throttle, two is ailerons, three is elevator, four is rudder. So I'm going to plug these things in. It's not a big deal if you do plug them in wrong, like you got your ailerons and your elevator mixed up. You just need to confirm that and switch them around before you actually go to fly the airplane. So I know this is my ailerons, so I'm going to plug it into two. I know this is my throttle, so I'm going to plug it into number one. And I don't know which ones these are. They're all the way back in the tail, so I'm just going to plug them in randomly. But before we plug this in, I'm going to pull off my prop, just in case. It's a good idea when setting up controls or doing stuff anytime, just take this thing off. I'm going to fire up my radio and plug this in. Now I'm going to check out my flight controls. So basically, I got my elevator right here. And I can see my rudder servo is moving, which is so the wrong one. So 4 and 3 need to be swapped. Now when I move my elevator, that surface moves. And when I remove my rudder, that surface moves. One of the things we need to do is we need to go and tighten up our linkages because as you can see, that one kind of moves around and this one just fell out. So once your radius centered and all your trims are set, that basically means, you know, trim for trimming the plane to the left and right. Once those are centered, you can actually center those linkages up. I want to make sure that's nice and tight. And also, it's a good idea to put your servo screws in too. So I'm going to do that as well. So now once we've centered our controls and tightened them down, it's a good idea to verify that they're going in the right direction. So to do that, I'm going to pull back on my elevator. And I can see this goes up, so the plane's going to pitch up when I do that. Left rudder. I can see it's going the wrong way, so I'm going to go reverse on my radio. Now it's a good idea, if you guys are still new to this, check out the Tiny Trainer video or the FT Explorer video. Those go real in depth on how to actually set up these controls. It may be a different airplane, but the concepts are all exactly the same. The next thing for this plane is the throw gauge. Now, I don't really use throw gauges, and this plane is actually very, very forgiving to even crazy throws. It flies really good in almost all settings. But basically here, you have a 25 degree high, a 12 degree low. And what these basically do is these basically numb down the rates. So if you are a beginner, definitely check out the Tiger Trainer video or the FT Explorer video to show you how to use these throw gauges. But basically how this works in a nutshell is I basically hold to the bottom surface or flat part of the wing and move my control surface. If it goes beyond that, then I know I have too much throw. Basically, what your goal is to kind of dial it down so it kind of sits flush with this surface. Once everything's done with our controls, I'm going to glue on the receiver too. This has some Velcro on it, but I don't really have the opposite end, so I'm just going to tack it down with some hot glue. Now, it's a good idea to tack the receiver down somewhere a little bit above the water line in case the plane does start accumulating water. If it does accumulate water, the plane does sink to about up to this level right here. And that's even when it's full of water, because the plane is made out of styrofoam, so it's technically going to continue to float. So I glue the receiver just about right there. And I'm going to route my antennas, well, antenna in this case, just out the side. You can mount the antenna inward, but for proper antenna installation, you want one going this way, and then one going 90 degree parallel to it. But I only have one antenna because this is broken off, but the receiver is still fine for close proximity flying. So once we're done with that, the last thing is our battery install. Check our rotation, our motor rotation, and get the weight and balance of the airplane. So I'm gonna slip the battery in about right here, and then I'm gonna check for CG, and you kind of measure it with your fingers. You basically just balance it to see where it goes. Well, it's also good to secure this thing down too, so it's not shifting all around. Now the CG is about 1.75 inches away from the leading edge of the wing. But you can go as far back as about 2 inches, but for a new pilot, 1.75 to 1.5 inches works great. My CG is roughly around somewhere in this ballpark right here, just a little bit above this little notch for the spar. So I'm gonna plug it in. And the last thing to do is check motor rotation. So as I can see, it's spinning, but it's turning this direction. And for this propeller, turning this direction is the wrong way, because you basically can see the way blades work is they're shaped like a paddle, and this basically means it's going to be paddling backwards and blowing air that way. So we don't want that. So basically we have these three wires, just switch any of the two wires to get it to spin the other way. Now you notice, it spins the other way. So now we can tuck the wires back in there. Now it's a good idea to secure this too. So basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull my receiver up here through the battery lead and secure it to the airplane to keep these from coming back into the propeller. I'm going to take this off, put that on, and then tighten this nut. So that pretty much completes the whole airplane.
Now, I have some precautions to tell you before you do try to man your first seaplane. If you can, enable the brake on the ESC. For some reason, the E-MAX ESCs right now, the brakes aren't really working. If you guys can figure out how to show me how to do that, or maybe I'm just doing something wrong, be sure to post a video in the comments, one-upping me pretty much. But if you can, turn the brakes on because the plane glides a lot better with the brake on in this case. But let's go and put it in the water. First things about the water, when you choose your flying site, try to choose your site downwind of where the wind is blowing, because if the wind is blowing and your plane ends up upside down in the lake, it'll blow back towards you, so you don't have to go out there and swim forward, or it blows somewhere else across the lake. So without further ado, I'm gonna put it in. And it's actually blowing a lot around here right now. So this is probably like a good 20 mile an hour wind, so I expect the ground roll out to be 3 feet or less. All right, let's put it in the water. A few notes about the pontoons too. When you do get rolling, they immediately push themselves out of the water, just like that. So just get a little bit of ground speed going and they pop right out of the water. Taxiing is fairly easy. If you do get stuck in a turn, just pull the power out, let the plane come to complete stop, and then kick the rudder over and you should be able to turn around. But I'm going to take off right now. That takes off nice and straight. You do need to add a little bit of right rudder on your takeoff roll, mainly because the elevator, or the rudder, it's fairly large already, but it could use it to, it could stand to be just a little bit larger. Apart from that, flying is as simple as just flying a Fortuner airplane. It behaves just as normal. Knife edge is easy. Just pop it over on the side and it'll hold that position. And that rest of characteristics such as stalls and spins are easy. Favorite thing to do is to take this plane up and just push the nose over and add a lot of power. And we'll do spins. Now because it's so windy, I'm gonna cut this flight kind of short. So I'm just gonna come around, land it, and show you guys how to taxi it back. So I'm just gonna set up my approach, fly downwind. And another good idea to do if you're first flying a seaplane is to land facing into the wind. Because if you land going downwind, it's very likely that the wind comes, picks up the tail, and flips the airplane upside down, causing you to have a really, really, really wet airplane. It's so windy. All right, here comes the vertical landing. Flop. Now, if you're back taxiing downwind, it's a good idea to hold a lot of elevator pressure. That keeps the tail firmly planted, so the wind is less likely to grab you in the water. Well, just like that. See, that's what happens when the wind grabs you. So pick a calm day to do this. So I guess this wraps this episode up. Pro tip, don't fly in really windy conditions and have a spare boat on hand to go get that thing, because I have to go get it now. So I'll see you guys next time.